Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The First Black Archaeologist, A Life of John Wesley Gilbert, by John W.I. Lee. Narrated by Bill Andrew Quinn. Foreword. I first learned of Paine College as a boy attending Williams Institutional CME Church in Harlem, New York in the 1950s. The church's music director, Dr. Keptalia Dent Newbern, was a Paine alumna. She had a doctorate in education from Columbia University, 1954, and also a master's degree in social work from Columbia. In 1980, at the age of 80, she would earn a doctorate in ministry from United Theological Seminary in Ohio. At her own expense, Dr. Newbern sent an older friend of mine, Woody White, to Paine College. Woody graduated in 1958. 10 years later, he was named General Secretary of the United Methodist Commission on Religion and Race, a position he held until 1984, when he was elected a bishop in the United Methodist Church. He recently retired from Emory University, where he served as bishop in residence. Channing Tobias, a 1902 Paine graduate and a former student of John Wesley Gilbert, was associate pastor at Williams Institutional. I needed no further convincing of the value of a Paine College education. When I arrived at Paine College in 1960, the president was the Reverend E. Clayton Calhoun. He served from 1956 to 1970 and was Paine's last white president. President Calhoun was preparing for the 50th anniversary of John Wesley Gilbert's mission to the Congo with Bishop Walter Russell Lambeth, senior bishop of the Methodist Episcopal Church South. President Calhoun greatly admired John Wesley Gilbert. One could not be at Paine in those days without hearing stories of Gilbert and Lambeth. John Lee and I met online in 2016. I was researching the history of Paine College for a book that I am writing. John and I were convinced via email by President Calhoun's son, the Reverend Ashley Calhoun, a United Methodist minister. Together, we began to talk about John Wesley Gilbert. In 2017, John made his first visit to Augusta and Paine College. As the college historian, I took him to see the important places and monuments of Gilbert's life. We began at the Gilbert Lambeth Chapel, a monument to the two men who founded one of the first Methodist missions in Africa. We walked Paine's historic campus and explored the historic black neighborhoods of Augusta, looking for the addresses where Gilbert once lived. We went to Springfield Baptist Church, where the Augusta Institute, which later became Morehouse College, was founded in 1869. Gilbert attended Augusta Institute as a teenager, and, at Paine, he later taught John Hope, the first black president of Morehouse College and Atlanta University. We visited the village of Hephzibah, now a suburb of Augusta, where Gilbert was born into slavery in 1863. We ended our tour in Cedar Grove Cemetery, where Gilbert is buried. John knelt at Gilbert's grave for many minutes. He said nothing. He appeared to be in deep communion with the man he had spent so many years researching, tracing his journey from Augusta to Brown University to London, Paris, Athens, and beyond. Now, for the first time, he had finally caught up with Gilbert in Cedar Grove Cemetery. And for history's sake, John knew that he had to resurrect him. In this book, John tells the story of how Gilbert earned the distinction of being the first black archaeologist. He explains Gilbert's work at the American School of Classical Studies in Athens, Greece, and his archaeological excavations and surveys at the ancient city of Eretria. Gilbert was only the third African-American to attend Brown University. And in 1891, he became the first African-American to earn an advanced degree from Brown. But as John reminds us, John Wesley Gilbert was more than the first black archaeologist. He was Paine College's first student in 1884, its first graduate in 1886, and in 1888, its first black faculty member. Paine College, which opened in 1884 as Paine Institute, has a unique interracial history. It is the only college started by former slaves and former slave masters. It is the only school founded by black and white Southerners as an interracial enterprise, whites working for and with blacks. It is the only college started cooperatively by a black denomination, the colored, now Christian, Methodist Episcopal Church, CME, and a white denomination, the Methodist Episcopal Church South, MECS. Gilbert and Lambeth's mission to the Congo was the second interracial venture between the CME and the MECS. A CME minister, Gilbert represented the CME Church and, thus, became the first CME foreign missionary. Gilbert learned several African languages and also served as French interpreter for Bishop Lambeth when dealing with Belgian officials. He was such a polyglot that it was said that as long as he was on the faculty at Paine College, Paine had the best foreign language department in the Southeast. Gilbert later headed Paine's theology department and briefly served as president of Miles Memorial College in Alabama. During his travels, Gilbert also studied people, especially the interactions between blacks and whites. CME minister J.C. Colclough, who wrote a eulogy of Gilbert in 1925, said Gilbert was the father of the interracial movement. Gilbert began teaching interracial harmony first in the Paine College Chapel programs, then in his public speeches, and always in his personal interactions. He preached that the mutual understanding required for peace and goodwill between blacks and whites must come through the church and church schools, and he believed that the church must generate the spirit and the schools must be the intellectual expression of that spirit of the church. The real question before the churches, Gilbert said, was how far they could gain and keep leadership in the new community movement, adding that the question could not be dismissed by hiding behind such expressions as separation between church and state, or dismissing the various issues as not being within the scope of church concern. The essence of the question, he said, is whether the church saw an opportunity for the immediate application of the good news of Jesus Christ, the gospel of goodwill and community problems. Gilbert believed, however, that what a church practices is more important than what the church advocates. He was fond of saying, "What you do speaks so loud that I cannot hear what you say." Remarkably, the first beneficiaries of the Gilbert program were Southern whites. For more than 75 years, Paine's white presidents, its white faculty members, and other white supporters of the school were ostracized to varying degrees in the Augusta white community and elsewhere in the South. George Williams Walker, the school's president from 1884 to 1911, his wife Susan and others suffered the slings and arrows of white ostracism in Augusta and other places in the South. And they all benefited from the counsel of John Wesley Gilbert, which served as a balm for their common pain. Recalling the rejection that he encountered because he was Paine's president and because of the school's interracial nature, Dr. Walker was often heard saying, "I just could not have made it by, were it not for Mr. Gilbert." Colclough said that Gilbert early understood and early began to teach one race ministering to the other. By training and unction, Colclough said, Gilbert had a special revelation of these needed facts to impart to the country, the immediate answer to which was that the white people of the South were the first to believe the message and to lead off in its understanding and goodwill. Kneeling at Gilbert's grave, John no doubt sensed the awesome weight of the responsibility of his book. To bring Gilbert to life in such a way that academia and history will finally and fully appreciate the work of this magnificent, extraordinary man. Dr. Mallory Millender, Augusta, Georgia, February 12, 2021. Introduction. Out of the Ashes. No one was sure how the fire started. In the pre-dawn hours of August 3, 1968, flames swept through the Haygood Memorial Hall, the main building of historically black Paine College in Augusta, Georgia. Hundreds gathered to watch helplessly as the blaze climbed up, engulfing Haygood's famous clock tower, which for nearly 70 years had rung out the hours loud enough to be heard across town. The structure was still smoldering at sunrise. The clock tower stood but was too damaged to save and had to be pulled down. Inside was devastation. Through fireproof cabinets protected recent student records, the offices of Paine's president and vice president were destroyed, along with a priceless collection of African artifacts. Many of the school's early catalogs, newspapers, and other records also perished. By 1978, a new building, Haygut Holsey Hall, would rise on the spot, but the papers burned that terrible night were gone forever. The tragic loss of so much of Paine's historical record has hindered study of the school's history and especially of its first student, first graduate, first black faculty member, and perhaps most famous alumnus, John Wesley Gilbert. The destruction was all the worse because a series of floods and fires in Augusta between 1880 and 1920, which often hit black neighborhoods the hardest, had already wiped away much written evidence of his life. Anything that Gilbert's family hung on to after his death in 1923 began to disappear as his children scattered from Augusta, and he had no grandchildren to preserve heirloom papers. By 1968, Paine held the last surviving copies of many documents of Gilbert's career. For much of the 20th century, John Wesley Gilbert was best known for his 1911 to 1912 mission to the Belgian Congo with White Bishop Walter Russell Lambeth for the Methodist Episcopal Church South, MECS, a mission that was chronicled in MECS publications, in Lambeth's writing, and in several books. The best of these books, Of Men Who Ventured Much and Far, was published by Paine College President E. C. Calhoun in 1961. Gilbert also appeared briefly as a background character in 1948 and 1998 biographies of his fellow Augustan John Hope, the first black president of what is today Morehouse College. Gilbert's 1890 to 1891 sojourn in Greece as the first African-American student of the American School of Classical Study at Athens, ASCSA, or American School, in contrast, often received passing word but never serious study. After his death, his name was soon forgotten outside Methodist circles. No reference to his pioneering contribution appeared in accounts of the development of classical archaeology or of the American school. Discussions of the history of African-American archaeologists, which drew on a different set of disciplinary and institutional perspectives, also left him out. Robert Slater of The Journal of Blacks in Higher Education, building on the work of Brown University archivist Martha Mitchell, mentioned Gilbert in his 1994 survey of early black university graduates, but it was only with the research of Michelle Valerie Ronick starting in the late 1990s, and especially with her traveling Black Classicists photo exhibition, that Gilbert returned to wider audience. In 2011, the newly founded Society of Black Archaeologists recognized him as the first professionally trained African-American archaeologist. Today, he is often called the first black archaeologist. Yet his life, and especially his year in Greece, has never received the in-depth exploration it deserves. 1890 to 1891 was no ordinary year. Gilbert was the first African-American and one of the first 50 Americans of any race, ethnicity, or background to attend the American School of Classical Studies at Athens, often called the American School or ASCSA. Founded in 1881 by a consortium of American colleges and universities to foster the study of ancient Greek literature, history, art and archaeology, the ASCSA was the United States' first overseas research institution and is today an internationally recognized research and teaching center. During his year in Greece, Gilbert was among the very first Americans to do professional archaeological work in Greece, indeed anywhere in the Mediterranean and Near East. Gilbert's journey to Greece received national attention in the African American press. He arrived at the American School during a pivotal stage of its institutional and academic development, amid hopes that Americans would soon be digging up ancient Delphi, only to witness the French when the excavation rites. He probably met Heinrich Schliemann, the excavator of Troy, and attended Schliemann's January 1891 funeral in Athens. Gilbert was the first American scholar to write about the urban demes, neighborhoods, or districts of Athens, a topic of fundamental importance to understanding Athenian democracy. His thesis on the deems won him a master's degree from Brown University, making him among the first African Americans to receive an advanced degree in classical studies. At Eretria, he took part in the widely publicized excavation of the Tomb of Aristotle and, more importantly, worked on one of the very first American archaeological and topographical surveys of an ancient site. In addition, Gilbert experienced Greece at a pivotal moment in the country's modern history. He watched as Premier Kyrillaos Trikoupis suffered a surprise election defeat to rival politician Theodoros Stelianis, and he saw firsthand how European influence, railroads, the international market for commodities such as raisins and tobacco, and the beginnings of mass tourism were reshaping the country's economy and society. Interest in African-American engagements with Greek and Roman classics, call it Classica Africana, Black classicism or something else, has burgeoned over the past few decades. This interest, however, has typically been framed in terms of Black receptions of and responses to classical literature, with much less consideration of archaeology or art history. Meanwhile, studies of African-American transatlantic travelers during the late 19th and early 20th centuries have tended to focus on Western Europe rather than Greece. There have been biographies of several of Gilbert's archaeological contemporaries, among them Annie S. Peck, the ASCA's first woman student, whom Gilbert probably met while at Brown University, British classic scholar Jane Harrison, whose books he read in Greece, and Eugenie Sellers, first woman to attend the British school at Athens, whom he met there, all of whom have significant archival trails. In contrast, researchers seeking to learn more about Gilbert in Greece face an apparent absence of sources. Paine's archives today preserve some crucial documents of the school's history, such as the trustees' minutes, that were not in Haygood Hall in 1968, but almost nothing directly related to Greece. The ASCSA archives have more to offer, including the records of the school's managing committee, but there are some notable gaps. For one thing, the notebooks from the 1891 excavations at ancient Eretria, in which Gilbert participated, are missing. My own research began with the American school's readily available 1890 to 1891 annual report, which provides an overview of Gilbert's activities but little detail. In search of more information, I decided to investigate the men Gilbert knew in Greece, students Carlton Brownson, Andrew Fossum, and John Pickard, and professors Rufus Richardson and Charles Waldstein. All five, I discovered, left behind invaluable evidence of the group's year together, including published articles and letters, personal reminiscences by Brownson, Fossum, and Pickard, and Waldstein's detailed diary. The official report's offhand mention of a Miss Harris led me to a trove of letters by Pickard's mother-in-law, Caroline Gerrish, and her niece, Edith Harris, who spent 1890 to 1891 in Greece and met Gilbert repeatedly. I found letters and articles by U.S. Consul Irving Manet, a frequent visitor to the American school, a diary by a young American traveler who met Gilbert at the school, and handwritten municipal records from the village of Neapsara, where Gilbert lived during the archaeological campaign at ancient Eretria. Thanks to a major digitization project at the ASCSA archives, I was also able to study several sets of glass plate photographs and film negatives taken at Eretria in 1891. Some of the negatives had been inaccessible before the development of new scanning technology around 2010. Another digital development proved crucial to recovering John Gilbert's story. Over the past decade or so, thousands upon thousands of old newspapers, periodicals, catalogs, books, and other documents in English, French, German, and modern Greek have become easily accessible and searchable through online databases. Such databases have their pitfalls. For example, I quickly learned to search for Gilbert and Filbert as well as Gilbert, T.W. as well as J.W. and John W., and a host of other variations, and, of course, many publications remain undigitized. Even so, these databases led me to reports of Gilbert's work in Greece, some only a sentence long, which otherwise would have been impossible to track down. I also searched obsessively for accounts by other travelers who visited Greece during the late 1880s and early 1890s, finding dozens more articles, essays, letters, and other materials that together provide a vivid, multifaceted picture of the country as Gilbert saw it. Most importantly, digital searching led me to some of Gilbert's own writing from Greece, originally published in now lost Augusta newspapers, but preserved in the form of quotations or summaries in other papers. These priceless fragments let us read his Greek experience in his own words. Though some large gaps remain, the archival and digital sources together are remarkably rich and diverse. Indeed, John Wesley Gilbert's year at the ASCSA is the single best documented year of his entire life. Gilbert's work in Greece was the culmination of 20 years of ceaseless striving for knowledge, beginning with its first school lessons in Augusta, Georgia, around 1870, and made all the more remarkable because he was born into slavery in 1863. Using a combination of archival and digital sources, in the first part of this book, I trace Gilbert's family origins, his early life, and his education in the public schools of Augusta, at the Baptist-sponsored Augusta Institute and its successor, Atlanta Baptist Seminary, at Paine Institute in Augusta, and at Brown University in Rhode Island. I show how Gilbert's early interest in Greek and Latin reflects a powerful current in post-Civil War African-American intellectual life, in which black leaders and educators saw the classical curriculum as providing access to the best intellectual traditions of their era and the best means to understanding their own historical development and sociological uniqueness, and ordinary black people, young and old, founding Greek and Roman classics a touchstone for learning and equality. I pay special attention to Gilbert's studies at Paine Institute, renamed Paine College in 1903, a unique cooperative venture of Southern black and white Methodists, and to his relation with Paine's white president, George Williams Walker, who would become a beloved father figure. I also focus on Gilbert's experiences at Brown, where he was the university's third African-American graduate, especially on his work with Albert Harkness, professor of Greek and a founding member of the ASCSA's managing committee. The last part of this book follows Gilbert's career after Athens, as he earned a national reputation as scholar, teacher, community and church leader, and missionary to Africa before dying prematurely in 1923. I show how Gilbert fell out of touch with the broader classics and archaeology professions as he focused on other priorities, especially raising money to sustain Paine College. I place Gilbert into the wider context of African-American history from 1890 to 1920, highlighting his educational and civil rights advocacy, while also noting how he, like many contemporary Southern black leaders, accepted white paternalism and segregation. I offer several new insights into his 1911 to 1912 journey to Africa, especially regarding his study of African languages. And while Greece did not define Gilbert's life, I reveal that his American school experience also remained personally meaningful to him and helped shape the rest of his career. In her biography of the pioneering Cambridge classicist Jane Harrison, Mary Beard writes of rejecting that tone of assured certainty in which most biographies strive to be written. The often fragmentary record of John Gilbert's life means that, from the start, I have accepted uncertainty, sometimes down to basic issues of chronology. Throughout the book, I foreground the challenges of interpreting ambiguous, conflicting, or missing sources, and I try to emphasize points in his life where Gilbert might have taken different paths. Beard also raises the question of the biographer's personal investment in their chosen subject. Beard's answer is to note how much she and Harrison share, particularly in their deep connections to Cambridge University. My life and John Gilbert's life, in contrast, are vastly different. Born into slavery, Professor Gilbert spent most of his life in segregated Georgia. I grew up in multicultural Hawaii, the grandson of immigrants from southern China and eastern Europe. What brought us together improbably was Greece, where I was a student at the American school a century after Gilbert. Exploring Gilbert's sojourn in Greece drew me onward to discover a world of African-American history that, as a historian of ancient Greece and Persia, I otherwise might never have encountered, and it led me to appreciate the centrality of both classics and Christianity in the Black intellectual tradition. Whether you already know him as teacher or archaeologist or missionary, or you are meeting him here for the first time, I hope that hearing about the extraordinary life of John Wesley Gilbert will lead you to new horizons. 1. Nursed in the arms of poverty. The boy was determined to write. It was Monday, the 1st of May, 1871, and he had come with his mother to open an account at the Augusta, Georgia branch of the Freedmen's Saving and Trust Company. The clerk opened his account register and took down the new customer's information. Age 7. Residence, Corner, Center, and Telfair Streets, just 2 blocks from the bank office on Broad Street. Occupation. Go to school to Miss Chestnut. Father. Tom Dasher. Mother. Sarah Dasher. Uncles. Gabriel, Simon, Jim, William, John, in that order. Then, as he usually did with young or illiterate patrons, the clerk wrote the boy's name on the signature line, added the notation, his mark, and offered the page for an X. The boy, however, insisted on signing for himself. He ran out of space on his first try, but succeeded on his second. The register still survives today in the National Archives in Washington, D.C., bearing a shaky but legible signature, Wesley Gilbert. Given that just a few years before it had been illegal in Georgia to teach a black person to read or write, this visit testimony of young Wesley's progress toward literacy is deeply moving. But that is not all. The names listed on this humble document enable us to reach decades back from 1871 into the darkness of slavery to restore to light the origins and the family of John Wesley Gilbert. Few 7-year-olds make such a contribution to writing their own history. Hephzibah Origins. As an adult, Gilbert reported his birthplace as the village of Hephzibah in rural Richmond County, southwest of Augusta. The names of his uncles, who need not have been biological uncles, and his mother provide our first clues there. In 1858, Dr. Samuel Clark of Hephzibah filed suit against landowner Henry Johnson for a decade's worth of unpaid medical bills. To show Johnson could pay, Clark's petition listed the property Johnson held in trust for his wife Mary Rhodes Johnson. The list included land just north of Hephzibah along a stream called Grindstone Branch and the names of 10 slaves. 5 of those names, John, Gabriel, Simon, Jim, and Sarah, matched the names from young Wesley's bank register. The conjunction of so many names, especially Gabriel, which appears rarely as a slave name in Georgia, coupled with the location of Johnson's land, makes it almost certain that these are Gilbert's uncles and his mother Sarah, just a few years before her son's birth. There is more. An 1850 lawsuit over the estate of Hephzibah grandee Absalom Rhodes Jr., the father of Mary Rhodes Johnson, lists 26 slaves to be divided among his children. This list includes a 10-year-old boy named Bill, probably Gilbert's uncle William, who was born about 1840, according to post-emancipation records. A 30-year-old named William on the list may be Bill's father, for the repetition of male names from father to son was common among enslaved people. Another 30-year-old, Jim, could be the namesake of Gilbert's uncle Jim. The most striking names, however, belong to the couple who had this 1850 list: Charles Gilbert, age about 75, and Nancy Gilbert, age about 70. While we cannot be sure of the exact relationship of Old Charles and Nancy, as the court papers called them, to the others named in the 1850 and 1858 documents, they are very likely the origin of Gilbert's surname. How did Charles and Nancy acquire the Gilbert name? The early history of Methodist Christianity in the Caribbean reveals a remarkable possibility. In 1757, a wealthy planter from the island of Antigua sailed for England, accompanied by 3 enslaved servants. The planner had read a pamphlet by Anglican priest John Wesley, whose followers were known as Methodists for their methodical pursuit of biblical holiness, and wanted to meet Wesley in person. The planter's name, Nathaniel Gilbert. In January 1758, Gilbert and his servants met Wesley near London. Wesley records the encounter in his diary. "I preached at Wandsworth. A gentleman, come from America, again opened a door in this desolate place. In the morning I preached at Mr. Gilbert's house. Two Negro servants of his and a mulatto appeared to be much awakened. Shall not his saving health be made known to all nations?" At the end of the year, Wesley baptized two of the slaves, describing one as "the first African Christian I have known." Gilbert and his three companions, whom later sources name Mary Alley, Sophia Campbell, and Bessie, returned to Antigua, where they built a Methodist community that still thrives today. Old Charles Gilbert, born about 1775, may well have gotten his name from that community and been brought from Antigua to Georgia as part of the thriving post-revolutionary trade in slaves from the West Indies. Perhaps Nancy, too, came from Antigua. The possibility of this Caribbean connection is bolstered by the fact that at least one white Gilbert certainly went from Antigua to Georgia. Nathaniel Gilbert's youngest son, William, who moved to Augusta in 1810 and lived near the city until his death in 1824. If Antigua was in fact the ultimate source for his surname, then John Wesley Gilbert bore a name about as Methodist as could be. While we cannot prove that Gilbert and his family had an Antigua origin or even that they were aware of the surname's significance, his mother used the name after emancipation, and young Wesley found it particularly meaningful. He insisted on having it on his bank register in 1871, even though his mother had taken Tom Dasher's surname, and even though some adults called him Wesley Dasher. We can follow the trail back in time from the 1850 Rhodes Estate lawsuit through court cases, tax registers, census slave schedules, probate records, and newspaper advertisements, as several multi-generational family groups were brought together, intertwined, and sometimes pulled apart. While the repetition of names from generation to generation and the lack of age figures in many documents makes tracking specific individuals very difficult, some ancestors of the enslaved people listed in Samuel Clark's 1858 petition can be glimpsed as far back as 1822. The most important source is the 1831 will of Mary Rhodes McTyre, elder sister of Absalom Rhodes Jr., and aunt of Mary Rhodes Johnson. To Mary and her six siblings, McTyre bequeathed seven slaves: Sarah, Solomon, Simon, Gabriel, John, Miranda, and Rachel. Given the overlap with the names on young Wesley Gilbert's 1871 bank register, these are very likely another set of his ancestors. The Sarah on this list might even be Gilbert's maternal grandmother. After her 1832 marriage to Henry Johnson, Mary Rhodes Johnson brought one or more of these seven with her to live along Grindstone Branch near Hephzibah, where they were joined by others Mary inherited from her father through the 1850 lawsuit. Sarah Gilbert was probably born at the Johnson property around 1843, and it was probably there that she gave birth to her only son on July 6, 1863, a few days after the Battle of Gettysburg. By then, the war had come home to the Johnson property. The oldest Johnson son had been killed in battle at Malvern Hill, Virginia, in July 1862, and two of the three remaining sons were away in the Confederate Army. Though he appears as simply Wesley on his 1871 bank register and in the 1870 census, the boy was probably christened John Wesley. The Johnson family had a connection to the Methodist Episcopal Church, South, MECS, a pro-slavery denomination that had split in 1844 from the original Methodist Episcopal Church founded by John Wesley's followers in 1784. In the 1850s, MECS congregations in Richmond County and neighboring Burke County included many enslaved people. Gilbert's name suggests his mother was part of such a congregation and had the ability to choose her son's name. Not all mothers were so lucky. Frederick Douglass recounts, "once seeing a colored babe at the altar ready to be baptized, the old preacher took him in his arms and asked his mother what the name was to be. I want him called John Wesley, she answered. Oh, pooh, he exclaimed. No John Wesley's here. And he began to hastily pour on the water, saying, I baptize thee, Pompey. Gilbert did not live long in Hephzibah. With the Confederacy collapsing, Sarah took her baby a dozen miles north to Augusta. Nearly a century later, Augusta-born Lucius C. Harper, editor of the famed Chicago Defender newspaper, recorded an oral tradition about this journey. Gilbert's mother, when freed walking all the way, brought him as a child in a clothes basket on her head to Augusta, where kindly residents took them in. When Gilbert and his mother left Hephzibah is unknown, but in October 1864, Augusta's mayor noted that the city's black population had tripled over the past year. Union General William Sherman's march from Atlanta toward the sea spurred an even greater influx of black and white refugees, especially after Sherman's cavalry raided Waynesboro, less than 20 miles south of Hephzibah, in December 1864. In Augusta, Sarah and her baby found disorder, confusion, and crime. The Confederate surrender in April 1865 led to riots and violence. Federal forces, including units of black soldiers, arrived in May to restore order. Administrators, teachers, and others soon followed. Freed servants deserted en masse, leaving their bewildered former masters and mistresses to hire new arrivals just in from plantations in the surrounding counties. Sarah probably found work as a servant in one of these households, enabling her to feed, clothe, and shelter her little boy. Even if she found a kindly employer, it was no easy life. Years later, Gilbert would recall being nursed in the arms of poverty. While later legend named his father Gabriel, young Wesley seems to have known nothing about his biological father. Instead, his Freedmen's Bank register lists Tom Dasher as his father. Sarah Gilbert had met Dasher sometime after arriving in Augusta. 7 years older than Sarah, Tom was something of a rake, at least as far as the newspapers portrayed him. In June 1866, he was fined for disorderly conduct. A few months later, he was back in court for discharging a pistol within city limits, though he convinced the judge he had shot at a dog in self-defense. Just before Christmas 1868, Sarah made her own court appearance as a plaintiff against Pauline Johnson, a rival for Tom's affections. Sarah had hurled a brick at Pauline, knocking out a few teeth, at which Pauline assaulted Sarah. During the proceedings, it was alleged that Pauline and Sarah were just two of Tom's no less than six lovers. When this was clearly shown, claims a news report, both consented to give up the investigation and Dasher too. In the end, though, Sarah and Tom settled down. They may have had a baby together, for Gilbert's bank register notes one sister died, though it is possible Sarah had the child before meeting Tom. Either way, Wesley's sister died young, leaving not even her name behind. By June 1870, census records show Sarah, Tom, and Wesley living on Augustus Green Street in a prosperous white neighborhood. Sarah worked as a servant for the widow Mrs. Tolliver, T-A-L-I-A-F-E-R-R-O, pronounced Tolliver, and her family, while Tom hired out as a laborer. Almost next door to the Tollivers was the Houghton Institute, a city-run free school that enrolled several hundred white children, and for a time, Mrs. Tolliver's sister ran a private school in a nearby house. Though the census indicates Tom was completely unlettered, it also indicates Sarah could read but not write. How well she could read and where she learned is unknown, but her influence, coupled with the presence of so many students so close by, must have shaped Gilbert's lifelong interest in education. Sarah and Tom made sure Wesley attended one of the new community schools for black children. Nearly all the other black parents in the neighborhood did likewise. Mrs. Tolliver died in February 1871, and her household split up. By May 1871, Sarah, Tom, and Wesley had moved a few blocks west from Green Street to the corner of Center, today 5th, and Telfair Streets. 7-year-old Wesley was now living in the heart of Augusta. At the southwest corner of his new intersection was one of the city's best-known houses, an extravagant mansion dubbed Ware's Folly, after its builder, Augusta Mayor and U.S. Senator Nicholas Ware. Ware's Folly had a new owner in 1871, cotton broker and industrialist William Sibley, who moved in around the time Wesley arrived in the neighborhood. Other prosperous whites lived around the intersection, their homes interspersed with quarters for black servants and laborers. Handsome new residences were starting to fill up vacant lots, and the air soon rang with the noise of the hammer and saw and the clatter of brick. A block west of Longtail Fair from Ware's Folly were City Hall, the Academy of Richmond County, the Medical College of Georgia, and Augusta's Synagogue. On the blocks after that came a Presbyterian church and then a Catholic church, convent, and school. Across from the Catholic church was a school for black teachers and preachers called the Augusta Institute. It was closed when Wesley got to Center and Telfair, but the rumor was it would soon reopen. How long the family stayed in this neighborhood and on which side of the intersection they lived, we cannot say, but they seem to have found a measure of stability, for Tom and Sarah formalized their marriage in August 1873. The Public Schools of Augusta. While the Civil War still raged, thousands of newly free black Americans, young and old, had thrown themselves into learning. Many more followed after the war. Their spirit was immortalized in 1868 when former Union Army General O.O. Howard visited Atlanta. Howard was commissioner of the Bureau of Refugees, Freedmen, and Abandoned Lands, better known as the Freedmen's Bureau, established in 1865 to assist former slaves and poor whites in the South. "What shall I tell the children in the North about you?" Howard asked a lecture hall full of young black students at the Stores, or Stores School in Atlanta. A 12-year-old boy, Richard Robert Wright, cried out the answer, "Tell them, General, we're rising!" Wright's response inspired a famous poem by John Greenleaf Whittier and became a rallying cry for black education. Although some African Americans emphasized practical industrial training, a stance in later years most often associated with Booker T. Washington, for Wright and many others, the pinnacle of education was the classical liberal arts curriculum, including Greek and Latin. As minister and poet George C. Rowe would put it in an 1890 ode to black achievement inspired by Wright, "Within the classroom in his place, Greek, Latin, criticizing." Young Gilbert was fortunate to grow up in a city uniquely committed to education, whose free black population of less than 400 had sustained at least one secret school throughout the Civil War. When emancipation came, Augusta was one of a few places in Georgia that had many literate black people. Black Augustans quickly organized community schools and soon got help from northern missionaries. More schools were set up by the Freedmen's Bureau. In 1867, the Bureau turned its schools over to the black community, which operated them until 1872 with funds from the newly created Richmond County Board of Education. Visiting Augusta in January 1870, Freedmen's Bureau representative J.W. Alvord judged the city's schools, "among the best I have seen, not so much in advancement as in high tone and enthusiasm." Wesley Gilbert started school in 1869 or 1870. By 1871, he was in class at Trinity Church in Augusta's Second Ward, less than a mile southwest of Center and Telfair. Trinity had been organized in 1842 as an all-black offshoot from the biracial St. John's Methodist Episcopal Church. Its congregation included some of Augusta's elite free black families, notably the Harpers and Ladovizis. Gilbert's future wife, Osceola Pleasant, came from another of these families. It may be the two first met as children at Trinity. About the time Wesley was starting school, Trinity became part of a new independent denomination, the Colored Methodist Episcopal, CME Church, created by black members of the white-dominated MECS. In January 1871, 29-year-old Lucius Holsey became Trinity's first CME pastor. Though no record survives to prove it, the pastor and the schoolboy must have crossed paths early on. Gilbert might even have watched Holsey's ordainment as a CME bishop at Trinity in March 1873. Little did they realize how closely their lives would intertwine in years to come. Gilbert's teacher at Trinity, listed on his account register as Miss Chestnut, was 17-year-old Cecilia E. Chestnut. Born in South Carolina, Miss Chestnut had lived for a time in Philadelphia, where her mother was a shopkeeper. Her older sister Anna was married to Daniel Gardner, one of Augusta's few black grocers, who was active in local politics and at Trinity Church. Cecilia Chestnut was one of several educated young black women and men who played key roles in the early development of black schools in the city. Thanks to the surviving records of the Augusta branch of the Freedmen's Bank, we can tell that her interest in her students extended well beyond the classroom. In January 1871, Cecilia Chestnut opened her account at the Freedmen's Saving and Trust Company on Broad Street. Congress had created the Freedmen's Bank, as many called it, in 1865, to help freed slaves and their descendants build financial security. The bank rapidly expanded and soon had offices from Texas to New York, welcoming business from anyone. Newspapers in Augusta told black depositors the bank would keep their savings perfectly safe. The community poured in money, depositing more than $70,000 by 1872. The bank's agents visited black schools across the country to extol the virtues of saving, but Augusta's teachers were unusually active in signing up students. Indeed, the Augusta branch's first cashier, Charles H. Prince, for a time also had charge of northern missionary teachers in the city. The result was that school children opened a quarter of Augusta's Freedmen's Bank accounts. In the months after Cecilia Chestnut opened her account, her students, one after another, followed suit, all giving their occupations as "Go to School to Miss Chestnut" or "Chestnut." By 1872, at least 15, including Wesley Gilbert, had signed up. Judging from the regular intervals at which her students opened accounts, Miss Chestnut might even have gone with them to the bank office one by one. Miss Chestnut's classroom and Augusta's other black community schools were gradually merged during 1871 to 1873 into Richmond County's new public school system. Georgia's 1868 constitution guaranteed all children a thorough, free education, but white opposition had in most places stymied the development of publicly funded black schools. Augusta was different, not least because the county's Board of Education, uniquely in Georgia, had the power to set its own taxes. Although white schools always got more resources, black and white Augustans worked together to build a school system for black children. At first, there were only primary and intermediate colored schools, comprising 5 years in total. In 1876, 2 years of grammar, secondary school, were added. Until 1880, only white students could go on to 3 years of high school. The board used its funding to hire black teachers, including Augustus R. Johnson, the very first licensed black teacher in the entire state. Johnson, an early graduate of the Augusta Institute, began his career in another part of town from Gilbert, but the two would cross paths before decades end. By 1872, Gilbert was at the new Second Ward Colored School, a few blocks south of Trinity Church. Nearby lay the Augusta Ice Factory and its noisy, smelly ammonia cooling equipment. Gilbert's school probably resembled the one R.R. Wright Jr., whose father had shouted out, "We are rising," in 1868, attended in Augusta in the early 1880s. "The buildings," Wright recalled, "were of rough boards and equipped with blackboards and desks. The principal usually had a huge bell, which we all longed to ring, that was used for calling the children to school in the morning and at recess. Abundant switches, straps, and paddles were at hand for punishment." South of the ice factory, a new black settlement was growing in the open fields called Verdery's Territory. 6 years later, the Terry would be the boyhood neighborhood of singer James Brown, the godfather of soul. To the west of their school, young Wesley and his fellow students could see black workmen, soon joined by Chinese immigrants, digging to enlarge the Augusta Canal, a project that would transform the city. The Ice Factory School, as it was popularly known, had two teachers. One was Cecilia Chestnut, who would soon marry Thomas Harper of the influential Harper family. The other was John F. Quarles, whose father, Frank Quarles, had founded the first colored Baptist church, today Friendship Baptist Church, Atlanta's oldest independent black congregation. John Quarles had learned to read and write while enslaved. After emancipation, Massachusetts Senator Charles Sumner, a strong supporter of black civil rights and education, helped him go north to Westminster College in Pennsylvania. After graduating, Quarles worked in Sumner's office and studied law at Howard University before coming to Augusta. John Quarles was the first college-educated black man Gilbert ever met. Having studied Greek and Latin at Westminster, he could have given Gilbert his first exposure to these languages. Quarles did not stay long. Soon after becoming Augusta's first black lawyer in January 1873, he left to pursue a career in diplomacy and politics, but remained a familiar figure in Augusta and was an important early role model for young Wesley. 1873 was the year Wesley Gilbert turned 10. It was also the year of one of the worst economic crises in U.S. history. That September, fanned by the failure of the J. Cook Banking House in New York, financial panic swept the nation. In Augusta, there were bank runs, cotton prices plummeted, and local businesses advertised panic prices. The Augusta branch of the Freedmen's Bank survived the initial run by temporarily freezing withdrawals. There were attempts at reform in Washington, and in March 1874, Frederick Douglass stepped in as the bank's president. The cashier of the Augusta branch reassured the community the crisis had passed, but the effects of poor management, speculative investing, and executive fraud became increasingly clear. Congress voted to close the bank at the end of June. A few days later, Augusta's Broad Street office halted business. At the end of October, it closed for good. Like 100,000 other black depositors across the country, Wesley Gilbert had placed his trust in the Freedmen's Bank. His mother and stepfather could have deposited their earnings in his account, too. We can only imagine their hopes and dreams for these hard-won savings. Now, that money was gone. The bank's failure was just part of the malaise that gripped the United States for the rest of the decade. As Augusta's economy struggled, dark shadows reemerged. At the end of 1873, a monument listing the city's Confederate dead went up on Green Street. This modest memorial, reportedly the first of its kind in the nation, was followed in 1878 by a 72-foot-tall marble pillar that still stands today on Broad Street in downtown Augusta, flanked by statues of Confederate generals and bearing the inscription, "No nation rose so white and fair, none fell so pure of crime." The mid-1870s were perhaps the most difficult period in Gilbert's life. Just before Thanksgiving 1875, his stepfather Tom Dasher died. Gilbert had probably been working since he was a little boy. With his stepfather's death, he shouldered even more responsibility. Now growing tall and strong, as an adult he would stand more than 5 feet 9 inches, he earned money as a field laborer. As he later put it, 6 months of the year, I plowed, hoed, picked cotton, split rails, and spent the other 6 months in the public schools of Augusta. Picking cotton was exhausting, but at least it was over by the end of September, in time for school to begin. January was for hauling wood and splitting fence rails. Plowing and hoeing could pull Gilbert out of class as early as March or April, well before the official end of the school year. Meanwhile, one white Augustan judged 4 months school a year plenty enough for black children, writing, "It is not wise to offer inducements to a class of inferior mental capacity to enter in competition with the higher race, much less to pay their expenses in making the effort." With so much time out of school, only the most dedicated students managed to complete the entire course. Gilbert would become one of them, but he could not have succeeded without great teachers. He was fortunate that Augusta's public schools in the 1870s attracted a dedicated, highly skilled core of teachers. A few were older whites, notably Susan A. Hosmer of Massachusetts, who had come as a missionary in 1866 and would stay until she left for Atlanta University in 1886. The majority, however, were young black men and women. A half dozen women came from Atlanta University's teacher training program, or normal school. The first to arrive was Lucy Craft Laney of Macon, a member of the inaugural normal school graduating class of 1873, who would go on to become one of Georgia's most influential educators. Many of the other women came from Augusta's educated black elite. Almost all the men were graduates of the Augusta Institute, a Baptist academy just up the street from Center and Telfair. Teachers were assigned to schools by ward, and students were supposed to attend school in the ward where they lived, but as late as 1883, the residency rule was not enforced because Augusta's population distribution and school locations were mismatched. Wherever he lived in the city, it is possible that Gilbert remained at the Ice Factory School until he finished the intermediate grades in 1876. After John Quarles left in early 1873, a succession of star teachers rotated through the school. Miss Hosmer, then Harrison Bowie, an Augusta Institute graduate who would go on to become a missionary to Africa, and then in 1874 or 1875, no less than Lucy Craft Laney, in her first attested school assignment in Augusta. The possibility that Miss Laney taught young Wesley Gilbert is particularly tantalizing when we consider how and when he began learning classical languages. John Quarles had studied Greek and Latin at college in Pennsylvania, but Miss Laney had become skilled in Latin by age 12. When she arrived in the Second Ward in 1874 or 1875, Gilbert would have been 11 or 12. In an era when studying the classics had powerful political and cultural resonance for African Americans, Gilbert must have leaped at any opportunity to learn Greek and Latin. Miss Laney had begun her Latin studies by reading Caesar. It may be that Gilbert did likewise. Indeed, the Paine College Archives preserves one of his early class exercises, a halting translation of a passage from Caesar's Gallic Wars, a text commonly used for Latin teaching. If he in fact began learning classical languages in the mid-1870s, he was well ahead of the official school curriculum, which for white students introduced Latin in the first year of high school, and for white boys only, Greek in the second year of high school. Whether he got his first exposure from John Quarles, Lucy Laney, or someone else, Gilbert would become a linguist of pure distinction, learning French, modern and ancient Greek, German, Biblical Hebrew, Latin, and the African languages Chiluba and Otetla. It is here that A.R. Johnson, Georgia's first licensed black public school teacher, re-enters the story. In fall 1876, Johnson was appointed to run Augusta's first public colored grammar school. The opening of this school reflected both black community pressure and the Board of Education's commitment to continue funding black public schools. During the 1870s, Richmond County's all-white Board of Education rejected proposals to dump its black schools into a separate system and resisted other white attempts to avoid paying for black education. Against this opposition, Superintendent A.H. McLaws declared, "The prejudice against the colored schools has been diminished by the excellent conduct of both the teachers and pupils." In July 1876, Gilbert turned 13, becoming eligible for 2 years of grammar school. Since there was only one black grammar school, Gilbert must have gone to study with Johnson no matter where he lived in the city. Johnson's school began in the Second Ward, but by the next fall had relocated into the First Ward. When we are next able to locate Gilbert and his mother in Augusta through the 1880 census, they are in the First Ward. They may well have followed the grammar school there. There was also family in the neighborhood. Gilbert's youngest uncle Simon, who had become a railway man, he would die in a train accident in 1881, had moved to the First Ward around 1878. Thanks to A.R. Johnson, Gilbert was able to complete grammar school. During these years, Gilbert became interested in teaching. In 1921, black community leader Silas Floyd, who as a boy in the 1880s lived on the same street as Gilbert, recorded, "The first school Gilbert taught in his life was in Richmond County as an assistant to Dr. C.T. Walker, who taught school in this county some 40 years ago." During 1876 to 1879, Walker taught summer school at Franklin Covenant Baptist Church near Hephzibah, so Gilbert must have assisted him during one or more of those summers. Franklin Covenant Church was, and still is, just about 6 miles south of Henry Johnson's property, where Gilbert had been born into slavery in 1863. Augusta to Atlanta. When Gilbert finished grammar school in 1878, he had gone as far as the city's public education system.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.